All right. Good morning, MVCC. Thank you, Pastor Brian, for letting us know what's going on. So excited. Today's just a fun day after the service, just to hang out together, as you heard from Pastor Brian. So glad that you are here. I hope that you're glad that you're just in a place where we can just, God, you're amazing. So how about those Dodgers? Oh my gosh. I will say this. I have been a loyal Angel fan for about the last, 20, 30 years or whatever. My dad would take me to Angel games. Still love the Angels. But I got to tell you this, man, you can only take so much of being part of a losing team the last 20 years, right? When Freddie Freeman stepped up, right, the ninth inning, oh my gosh, I am sure when he stepped up to the plate, I got to believe every single MLB hitter, they are expectant and they are relying on the discipline of the gift God gave them. Even if they don't know the Lord, that's how it works. So when he went up to bat, man, and he hit that home run, I was like, I think I'm gonna be a Dodgers fan. So I told one of our brothers over here, man, who wears his Dodger jersey all the time during baseball season, I said, dude, I'm maybe thinking about migrating over. I'm not gonna leave the Angels, but dude, I wanna be a part of a team that's winning, right? You have been gifted. You have been anointed. If you are a believer in Jesus and you surrendered your life to God, he has gifted you, he has empowered you, and one of our roles here at MVCC is we want to give you every tool possible so that you can serve him, love him, and the greatest thing that we can bring to people is a heart, God-filled heart with love. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, man, we're just going through the book of 1 Corinthians. We looked at all these incredible gifts, the gift of wisdom, knowledge, faith, prophecy, tongues, interpretation of tongues, languages, all these giftings, spiritual giftings God gave us. If we're so focused on just the gift and the person using the gift but have no love, it doesn't work. Jesus said to his disciples, people will know that I'm alive because you preach great sermons. Nope. You serve people. That's important, but not that. If you love one another. Do you remember back in the day, if you were a Christian back in the day, about the 1970s, there was something that was happening in Southern California in Costa Mesa. All of a sudden, the Spirit of God was starting to hone around the Word of God, and a little Calvary chapel in Costa Mesa, all these hippies started flooding in to the church. And I was just thinking about this. There were thousands and thousands and thousands. I wasn't Christian at the time, so I didn't even know this was going on. But all these hippies were coming in with long hair, no shoes, smelly, didn't have jobs, but they found Jesus, man. And they were so excited about this born-again experience. This was a real thing. It wasn't an emotional high. It wasn't just a season of life. This was a real born-again experience by the living God touching every single one of them with love. And then they just wanted to love everyone else with the love of Jesus. And I think about that movement. It never would have taken off the runway if some of those people who had been in the church and said, what are you doing letting those hippies in the church? They got long hair, they smell, they don't work, they're messing up the carpet. I'm so glad for one bold person who saw the love of Jesus Christ in every single one of those young people and said, well, this might not be the church for you then. We gotta love people, man. Loving people means that it costs us something. It cost Jesus his life. The fact that he loves every single one of us here today. I don't want anyone leaving here in this moment, this next half hour, without knowing that you are deeply loved by God. And because God loves you, that does something on the inside of us. We're all searching for love. We're all searching for unconditional love. A love that we don't have to work for, earn, do something special to get it. It is an in-your-face love, unconditional. That God says, I just love you for free and I will never stop loving you. Even if you leave me, even if you walk away, even if you deny me, I love you as much as if you are passionately following me. I don't know what that does for you, but for me, it makes me want to love him more. And it makes me want to see people the way Jesus sees people. Church, we are on the brink. I believe revival has already started in our nation, in small pockets of our great nation of United States of America. And I don't want to miss it. I don't want to miss it because we were missing just loving people on our faces, praying to God, asking him, God, unless our nation has you again, we're lost. Join with me in this because I believe that God wants to do this. He is doing it, and I don't want us to miss it. When the Greeks wrote in their language, we're going to read 1 Corinthians 13 in just a moment, they had different descriptions for the word love. In our Western American culture, in English, we use the word love. I love my 4x4 truck. I love my golden retriever. And I love my wife. But we use the same word for all kinds of different things. Now, the love for my wife is so much different than the love for my truck. Truck's just a piece of metal, but I love it. These people, when they used the language, there were different words for the word love. For example, they had a word in the Greek for family type love. You love your family, even though you may not like your family, you love your family. You're stuck with them and you are called. My father was Italian, so it was always about food and family. You stick together as family, you work things out. In the church life, man, sometimes we're gonna rub up against each other, we're gonna offend one another, we're not gonna agree on everything, but we've got to work at loving one another. The gospel is at stake. People's lives are in the balance. And unless you and I get this thing called love, loving people for free, the revival might just pass us by. Listen, I believe God is looking for a church, a community of people. He's looking for people that say, yes, I believe in Jesus with my whole heart. I'm not the most perfect person. My life is messed up. You should have seen my life before I accepted Jesus. Now that I've accepted Jesus, it's a little half messed up, but God, I'm solely surrendered for you. God is looking for one. He's looking for a few. He's looking for a body of people that will say, we will love people into the kingdom of God. Everybody has an opportunity. Everyone should have an opportunity to hear and respond to the love of God, right? When we get this right, the vertical kind of love, the more I see how he views me, the more that I want to love him and love other people. And we can get this horizontal thing right. What's the answer to racism? Can we legislate morality? Can you make somebody love somebody? No. Laws and principles and all those things are good. Policies are good. But what really will bring change in our nation is a changed heart. A changed heart that says, God, I'm not much. But Lord, I love you. And I know now, I understand that when you died on that cross, you gave your life for me to cover my sin, to forgive me, to make me new, to transform my life. And not only do we get heaven, man, we get heaven on earth here too. Jesus says, I have come that you might have life and have it to the full, man. Revival's coming. We want to get this love thing right. Why? Because Jesus, I believe, as he will call so many people before the rapture happens and before Jesus returns, we want to be able to have as many people as possible at MVCC. If we got to have 7 services, we'll have 7 services. If we got to have Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, pray for our staff. But we are so committed. God, if you're moving, we'll do it, Lord. We want to make sure everybody has a seat. Why? To be a disciple of Jesus Christ. And love is the most excellent way. In 1 Corinthians 13, I want to read this in the context of division in the church. They had all kinds of problems. And they loved Jesus. They found Jesus. They were changed, but they went back into the old life. They were suing one another. They were gouging each other financially. They couldn't get their worship of idols even correct. They couldn't drop all their idols. They were worshiping still false idols and saying, yes, I love Jesus, but I'm following this false idol. They had no respect for someone who was young in the faith when they were just eating all kinds of meat in the marketplace that were sacrificed to idols. And these young believers would say, wait a minute, what are you doing? I don't care. I'll just do what I want to do. I'm a Christian. I'm saved. They had no respect and love for each other. And therefore, there was so much division and the just to put the icing on the cake and all these gifts, Paul says, don't be thinking it's all about you, man. You've been gifted. You have been given many gifts to serve him, but it's not about you. It's not about you, Pastor Mike. You're just a tool. You're a pawn on my chessboard. I'm using you so that everybody can see Jesus. At our church, you're not gonna see all these pictures of all the pastors. Pictures, we want pictures of you. You're the ones that are the servants. You are the leaders. We want people to see Jesus Christ. And loving him in a church family that loves each other. It's not perfect. We're never gonna be perfect. We're never gonna be everything we ought to be until we get there. But we're working on it. I think as many times I'm working on a sermon, I'm still working on a call. I'm trying. I'm trying to be loving, trying to not be selfish. And so I hope that the word of God brings and speaks to every one of our hearts about how do we do this thing well. Now, it's easy to love somebody who's lovable, but what about loving people who aren't nice? What about loving people who have backstabbed you, people who have lied about you, people who have taken your money, ripped your business apart, lied about family members? I mean, we could go on and on of the ways that we've been hurt and betrayed, right? Every single one of us here. You can't be breathing without experiencing some betrayal in your life, right? So how do we deal with that? Do we ignore it? Do we just put our head in the sand? Do we say it's not happening? I'll get them secretly. I know I got a plan. Let's drop all that. Let's just drop all that and read the text here in 1 Corinthians 13. So Paul says, this little letter about the apostle Paul, remember when these believers in Corinth were opening up this letter from a scroll, they didn't have the Bible like we have. So when the reader, the leader, the pastors would say, the letter came from Paul, people would pack into houses and small areas because they wanted to hear the word. What did Jesus say to us today? And he says this, if I could speak of all the languages of all the earth and all the angels, but didn't love others, man, I would only be a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I had the gift of prophecy, could understand all of God's secret plans and possessed all knowledge, and if I had such a faith that I could move mountains, but didn't love others, I would be nothing. If I gave everything I had to the poor and even sacrificed my body, I could boast about it, but if I didn't love others, I would have gained nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It does not demand its own way. It is not irritable. It keeps no record of being wronged. It does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Love never gives up. Amen. Love never loses faith. It's always hopeful and endures through every circumstance. Prophecy and speaking in unknown languages and special knowledge will become useless. But love will last forever. Amen. Now, our knowledge is partial and incomplete, and every gift of prophecy reveals only part of the whole picture. But when the time of perfection comes, these partial things will become useless. What he's saying is we are living in the last days, family. Friends, we are living in the last days, and these gifts we have been given by God are to simply serve others so that God can be glorified. But there will come a day when those gifts are no longer needed because we'll be in our perfect state. What is he saying about when the perfect comes? He's talking about Jesus Christ's second coming. When the perfect returns, we will no longer need these gifts because we're gonna be in heaven with Jesus forever. We'll be in our perfect state, a new body, a new mind, a new spirit, the way God intended us to be. Isn't that great? So verse 10, he says, but when the time of perfection comes, these partial things will become useless. When I was a child, I spoke and thought and reasoned like a child, but when I grew up, I put away childish things. Now we see things imperfectly, like puzzling reflections in a mirror, but we will see everything perfect in perfect clarity. All that I know is partial and incomplete, but then I will know everything completely, just as God knows me completely. And these things will last forever. Faith, come on, together. What? Faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. And I just want to ask that we come to this next few moments with just a childlike heart that just trusts and believes and not, well, this happened to me, and you don't know how I was wronged, and you don't know how I feel, and I was violated, and I gave trust, and they said, we just let all that go. Say, God, help me to live your most excellent way. There was a little girl that in the middle of a storm, she was up in the third story of a home back east. Lightning, thunder, rain was just pelting against the window. Mom tucked her into bed at night. She just felt led. Mom felt led to come back upstairs during the storm. She was a little worried that her daughter was afraid. And she saw her little girl, her daughter, with her chin on the windowsill, looking up out the window. She says, honey, what are you doing? She says, Mom, I think God is trying to take my picture. Yeah, isn't that? I just thought, man, Lord, that's the kind of heart I want. It's just come, Lord, you want me to love people? I'll do it, Lord. So in this text, we have a long list of what love is. My son and I don't know, about 10 years ago, we went down to San Clemente Pier. We took a camera and a microphone, and we just asked, hey, just random people, would you tell us, when you hear the word love, what do you think of? Man, we got, out of 20 people, we got 20 different answers, just some weird stuff. Jesus gives truth. He is truth. He's very clear about this is what love is. Jesus was asked in Mark, Matthew chapter 9, from a desperate father, his 911 call, his little daughter was sick, she was dying. Jesus, can you come save her? Crowds of people everywhere on his way, and on his way he said, of course I will. Crowds, I believe in this moment, because he was in a specific place, there was thousands of people pressing against Jesus. Some people just wanted to touch him. Some people just wanted to see him. Some people wanted to see a miracle. Others were there to try to entrap him and try to catch him doing something wrong, which Jesus never did. And on his way, in the middle of a crowd, Jesus says, someone touched me. Now, as holy and respectful and honoring as this moment is, I just gotta say, I'm probably like what Peter would have said. Come on, Lord. We've been pressed around by thousands of people. You're asking who touched. That would be like in Dodger Stadium, going to the World Series, and thousands of people are pressing to get to their seats, want to get their hot dogs and their drinks, and everybody's excited. There's anticipation in the air. There's an expectancy. We're gonna win. And there's this people pressing against us, and I'll say, hey, somebody touched me. That would be ridiculous. There's thousands of people around. But Jesus felt there was something different about this touch. This little woman who was sick in faith believed, if I just touch the hem of his garment, if I touch the tassel at the end of his robe, I know he can heal me. And what I love about this scene is that the crowd stopped for Jesus. Thousands of people, but Jesus stopped for one. I really want to just take a moment and let that soak in. Where were you when you knew God loved you? He died on that cross to save you, and you said, yes, where were you? He stops. I believe to every single person who've ever lived, Jesus gives opportunity, because why? He wants every single one of us to know you have been chosen, and I love you. I know that life and circumstances might be difficult for you right now, but I still love you. I will never stop loving you. I guess that's what makes loving people a little bit easier as a Christian, because if he is perfect, loved me through all my mess and all my sin and forgave me of all that, how in the world could I hold back love from anyone else? I do not have a right to hold back love. And you know as well as I do, we all live in the same world here in South County. People are looking for real and authentic love. They're looking for a real Christian. They're looking for someone who doesn't play the plastic game, who doesn't have all the right answers, because none of us do. But they're looking for someone who says, man, I love God and I'm trying my best, and I can't say I am not the most perfect person, and I've got weaknesses and I've got failures, but I'm trying. People are drawn to that. I think that's why so many people love Jesus, because he was so authentic. He was so down in the streets with everyone. He understood the questions. He understood the concerns. He felt people's pain. He was sympathetic. He was empathetic. And he was present. Amen. And that's what Paul, in this long list, this is not a to-do list. This is allowing the Spirit of God to soak our heart and remember that Jesus is kind. Jesus is patient. In fact, in Romans 5:8, it says, but God showed his love for us and that while we were still sinners. Every single one of us, when I was still running away from God, didn't want anything to do with God, making fun of Christians, even making fun of churches and Jesus, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Amen. Jeremiah 31:3, I have loved you with an everlasting love. Therefore, I have continued my faithfulness to you. And Ephesians 3:18, and you may have power to understand, as all God's people, he wants all of us to get this, to show how high, how wide, how deep his love is for every single one of us. Out of this text that we just read in chapter 13, especially the verses 3-8, where all these love is patient, love is kind. God showed me this about 10 years ago, and I just wanna keep just revealing what's really in the word to encourage us and equip us. But let's just look at something I just put up here. This is all scriptural. We know that God is love, right? 1 John 4:16, no question. And we know that Jesus is God, John chapter 1, in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God, right? Jesus is love, 1 Corinthians 13. And Jesus lives in us. So every time we see in 1 Corinthians 13, love is patient. Love is kind. Love keeps no record. Jesus is patient. Amen. Jesus is kind. Jesus keeps no record of wrongs. Jesus is not boastful. Jesus is not proud. Jesus is not self-seeking. Now, you really want to get real this morning? Or you just want to have a church service that everybody just pretend everything's fine? You with me? You want to get real? If Jesus lives in you, all right, you have accepted Jesus Christ. He sent the Holy Spirit into you. You have him. He will never leave you. The Holy Spirit is in you. You don't have to keep asking, God, give me more love. God, give me love to love this person. Give me love for my ex. Give me love for the Uncle Tom that, gosh, he's just always, every Christmas, every Thanksgiving, I can't. Uncle Bob is always, Lord, give me more love. You don't have to ask for more love. What we need to is we've already have the love. You have the Holy Spirit in you. And he's looking for people, ordinary people, who will just rely and lean and step out in faith. So Jesus, of course, is all those qualities. But what about us? This is dangerous. Someone asked us all to do this. Mike is patient. Mike is kind. Mike keeps no record of wrongs. Mike does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. Why are you laughing? Stick your name in there, right? But that's where we live as believers, right? This is where God wants us to live. We'll never, ever measure up to the perfection of his love. But we want to keep moving forward. We want to keep moving forward in love. And I found the best way to love people is practice, practice, practice. We know what we ought to do, but some of us, myself included, sometimes I just don't want to do it. I just don't want to talk to them. I don't want to see them. I don't want to be around them. It's my flesh that rises up, and I can justify anything, right? We can justify any behavior. It's easy to do that. But Jesus says, I'm not looking for people to justify. I'm looking for people who are sanctified. I'm looking for people who are sanctified by my blood, who will say, okay, Lord, I know, you know, God, my heart. I really want to take this person out in Jesus' name. I want to take them out. Fire from heaven, Lord. Jesus had been loving people for 3 years. It was James and John who said, Lord, we're going into this town. You know they don't like you. Do you want us to call fire from heaven? Anybody here identify with that? And Jesus says, no, man, that's not my way. That's not my kingdom. I have this $50 bill. It's crisp. It's, yeah, the way things are going, this only buy a dozen bananas. But anyway, its value is 50, right? But if I drop that 50 on this surface, rub it, stomp on it, let's get some place where it's dirty and tough. Vito cleaned this place before service started. I was hoping this would be a little more dirty, but I'm just gonna get, and I'll tell you what, this value, even though it now is a little bit marked up, it's still, the value is the same, $50, isn't it? Now if I crumple this up, right? And I open it up. What is the value of this? I'll tell you what, brothers and sisters, sometimes I feel like I've been stepped on. Sometimes I feel like I got marks all over me. I wasn't very spiritual the other day. I totally missed an opportunity. God, I totally wasn't thinking about you. I didn't even pray as much as I really, all the things that we just get caught up in. And sometimes I feel so crumpled up, but the value, your value to God is still the same. Anyone here today thinking, God, there's no way you could love me. God, there's no way that I could serve you. There's no way that I could be used of you. You're wrong. That is so the enemy. You are valuable to him, so valuable that he laid down his life to die on a cross. In London, this was amazing. In London, there was an ice factory that actually, watch this, caught fire. This is a documented, it's truth. It caught fire. They called the fire department to put the fire out. What was the reason that they couldn't put the fire out themselves? Because all of their assets were frozen. My heart can get so cold. The more I justify, the more I hold back love, the more that I don't forgive, it's like, it just keeps getting like a, the Bible says, like a hot iron, my heart gets seared and I lose compassion. I squelch the Holy Spirit. And who's the one that's really in prison when we don't love and we don't forgive? It's me. Love is a decision, family. We gotta make decisions. Sometimes, I'll be honest, I don't wanna, but I know it's the right thing to do, regardless of how I feel about it. Anybody here with me? Amen. Love can bring together anything that's divided, anything. If God says, I am the God of the impossible, then he can do anything if we simply will love. God can bring any division back together. Even the Corinthian church, they were so messed up. And the last one, the last truth out of this is love invites us to see how Jesus views us. The more I see, I want to say this again because I need this today. The more I see how he views me, the more I want to love people just right where they are. What we need, family, what we need, brothers and sisters, is to not look at the world and say, if they got it right, if they did this, then they can come to our church. That'd be like going down to Mission Hospital with a broken arm, walking in on a wheelchair, and the nurse says, oh, you can't be here. Why can't I be here? Because you're sick. The church is the hospital for sick people. We were all sick. Some of us are still sick, right? But we're trying. These doors are always open for anyone. Anyone can come to Jesus Christ. I don't care what behavior, I don't care what language, I don't care what skin color. Everybody is loved by God. And us loving people, that's what people are looking for. Okay, then I'll listen to your God. I'll listen to your gospel. I'll accept your Jesus because I see it in you. Just a couple of things. There's a lot here inside of the insert. There's there and also on the app. There's some things we can do out of this. I just want to wind this down with this. And you can pick out whatever you like, whatever the Holy Spirit is leading you to do. Before you judge someone, get to know them. Yes, amen. How come the pastor wears holy jeans? How come the worship people wear holy jeans? Because we're trying to be more holy. I don't know. It doesn't matter about the jeans. It matters about the heart, right? It's the heart. We want to see somebody's heart. It's not that we excuse sinful behavior and just say, oh, well, you can just do whatever you want and be a Christian. That's not what he's saying. He's saying there is truth, there are absolutes, but he's saying if I know somebody's heart, I might understand why they do what they do, and now I can really start praying that God gets serious with somebody in their heart and they say, you know what, I need to give up this behavior because I just can't do it anymore because I know there's so much more for me in Jesus. Amen. Second thing is this, listen. Well, I tell you what, the older I get, I'm trying to do more listening than talking. Listen to someone attentively. Eye contact, look at them, response. Oh, that must have been difficult for you. Tell me more about that. That sounds interesting. The eye contact and the verbal cues of letting somebody know that your heart is really engaged. If you're wanting to tell somebody about Jesus, you gotta be interested in their life. You gotta climb into their circle. You gotta climb into their nightmare. Jesus was willing to step into anyone's nightmare because why? He is God Almighty, and there is no one that comes before him. There is no one that will come after him. God is in you. Don't be afraid to love somebody. I know it's hard. My father always taught me humility always wins the game. It might not win in the moment, but love and humility in the long run will always win. Why? Because the more that we love somebody in Jesus, our heart changes. My heart softens. My heart becomes more pliable and moldable. I can become a better parent. I can become a better father. I can become a better husband. I can become a better friend. I can become a better coworker. The more that I let Jesus' love touch my heart and love other people. Next one is this, you have the Holy Spirit to love people. I understand sometimes we gotta ask, Lord, you gotta give me something here to love this person. But doctrinally, you don't need to keep asking. You've already been given his love. You have his Holy Spirit, just act on it. You know how somebody wants to be loved. Man, one of my love languages is gift giving. I love when Laura gives me gifts. So I was giving her gifts younger, and when we're younger and early married, I'd give her gifts all the time, flowers and stuff and cards coming home from work. And well, I didn't do this every day, but I mean, I was trying. Finally, you know, she says, I love that you're trying. And she says, I really don't like gifts. What I really like is, and then she told me her love language. I think sometimes we're trying to love the world the way we want to be loved. And Jesus says, I need you to know someone and how they operate so that you can love them the way they need to be loved. Does that make sense? Jesus treated Mary and Martha very different. When Lazarus died, Jesus, you could have saved our brother. Where were you? Martha was, I believe, indignant. Jesus gave Martha a very clear scripture. I am the resurrection and the life. Your brother will raise again, and someday you will all be raised again. But Mary was weeping. She was crying. She was more emotional. So Jesus, I believe, hugged her and consoled her. Yeah. We're all wired a little bit differently. I got to find out what makes this person a tick so I can love them, right? What's the next one? Pray for them for 30 consecutive days. Oh my gosh. Everybody can do this. I'll pray for them. I'll pray that they get theirs. No. We're praying everything we want in our life. Lord, bless my life. Make me more like Jesus. Help me to be more sensitive. Help me to be more disciplined in my walk with you. All those things that we want, we're praying for that person. For 30, I guarantee you, 30 days of prayer for somebody, something's gonna change. Amen. And usually it's me. Yeah. It may not change the circumstance, but it's gonna change me. Be willing to forgive. We know this. Jesus forgave us. Why not forgive everyone else? Celebrate the success of others. And you got a new Tacoma. I'm so happy for you. Even though I really want one, I'm so happy for you. Refuse to mistreat others. I'm not going to do it. I'm going to hold back. I am not going to mistreat somebody else. Why? Because they are like that valuable coin. They are like that valuable currency to God, and therefore they're valuable to me. Refuse to take pleasure in the misfortune of others. Oh gosh, these are all just so Jesus-like. You know, just my heart is that, gosh, what did God speak to me today? Love. Because he loved us, because he loved me. God, I know I can love others. You know, I was thinking about as we have communion time in the seat back in front of you, there's a small cup with some bread and some juice. Every week, we just have opportunity for us to take a quiet moment and just remember, what is it all about? Why am I here? Most importantly, who's here? He's here. We remember his body, tortured and beaten, and the blood that came from the nails on the cross so we could be forgiven. This moment is just for us to take that quiet time and reflect and remember, and most of all, just getting right with God to repent. Look, God already knows everything we've ever done. You don't have to hide it. He already knows. Something happens when we quietly confess, God, you know, some of the stuff, I just ask you to forgive me. There were yelling, they were screaming, Hosanna, save us. And then 6 days later, crucify him. Yeah. And there was silence at the cross. But God was speaking his most loud way that only God can speak. I love you.
Hey, this is Pastor Mike. I am so glad that you tuned in online. And if you're ever in the area, we would love for you to join us at one of our weekend services. If this helped you in any way and you want to help us out with a gift, you can do that online. And we look forward to hopefully seeing you again soon.